let's talk a little bit about mastitis then. So is it hereditary? Like, can it go down through the line? Because if she's always throwing female kids, mm-hmm. do we have to worry about those kids eventually?
So mastitis is not hereditary. It doesn't pass from, you know, down the line. Mm-hmm. It's an infection. It's inflammation of the mammary gland. And with good husbandry, with good management, it's something that you can prevent. So it's not something that you have to worry about. If the mom has mastitis, the kid does not have to come and have mastitis. So it's a management tool, and these things you need to put into practice to ensure that you prevent that. And some of these things that you do, you ensure that if the kids are not suckling, you have to milk out that animal. Sanitation has to be good at all times. If people are milking those animals, you want to ensure that hands are clean or whatever. If they're wearing gloves, hands mm-hmm. should be clean at all times. And if you look at milking parlors, you know, you run a goat farm, if you look at cow farms, what they do is that they clean the teeth for the mammary gland thoroughly before. And as soon as they finish milking, they will apply iodine solution, because then the teeth cannula is now left open, and then you don't want bacteria to actually enter through that, what we call ascending infection, go up inside there and cause infection, and then you have mm-hmm. full-blown mastitis. And, you know, with some of these, the treatment for some of these are varied. You know, some people tend to put mastitis treatment up the teeth, not very effective. Because with some of these, you're talking about systemic problems where animals become very sick, lying down, there's lots of bacteria circulating, lots of toxins circulating in the body. So you really need to do systemic treatment, and that's the best thing when you have mastitis. Early treatment, systemic treatment, that's the best thing in terms of getting the animal back to full speed.
Yeah, we tried to do the injecting in the teeth, and it was just hard to do, and it wasn't going anywhere. It was just kind of spewing everywhere. I'm like, this is not working.
Those things are basically, in my opinion, they are for prophylaxis. When you're weaning animals, when you're drying off your animals, and you're not going to milk them again, you want to actually put some antibiotic up your teeth to ensure that you don't have any ascending infection taking place right there. So, but for treatment, systemic treatment is the best way to actually deal with these problems.
Okay. So you mentioned sanitation. Mm-hmm. So you mentioned it in light of milking. Of course, the milking parlor should be clean, and because you don't want any infection to go back. I forgot the fancy word to use, to go back up in the teeth to infect the mother. But can sanitation also affect the health of your herd?
Yes, sanitation is key. If your floor is always messy, dirty, if we're talking about kids right now, if you have them on the ground, if it's cold, if it's wet, mm-hmm. what basically you're doing is you're helping the animal to, you know, you're reducing the animal's own immune system. And once the immune system has gone down, the animal is open to all sorts of things. Mm-hmm. And they don't really need to have to get bacteria from the outside. We have bacteria living in our throat, in our intestines, and all over the place. And once your immune system is gone, the immune system is like the policeman of the city. And once you take them away, all of those bacteria, they have leeway to actually invade and cause problems. And that's the same thing you have with problems like Clostridia while you vaccinate. Because once the immune system is gone down, then the Clostridia, they can replicate and multiply and produce toxin, and the animal die within a few hours. And so it is key that sanitation be, you know, the number one thing that you put in your farm. Ensure that the place is always clean, and not just sanitation. Biosecurity is also important, because you can't really have people running from God knows where and straight into your barn. And we talked about that the last time we were there. It is a major, major concern. And we've seen people even in Europe who did not practice good biosecurity. Let's not people, veterinarian who did not practice good biosecurity, move from one farm to the other. There was one particular vet in Belgium who actually got delisted. So he lost his license because he was moving from farm to farm. And when they tracked that disease issue that they were having, they tracked it straight back to him. And, you know, he actually lost his license. So something that looks simple as that, but it's not really very simple.
So explain to us, what is biosecurity, and what are some practices that we need to put in place in order to practice biosecurity?
So, you know, if you break up the word bio, you know, we're talking about biological organisms, human beings, other animals, and security. We all know what that is. So you're trying to secure your place from that. And, you know, the number one person that you really need to look at is your vet. So don't think it's the other farmer, the other person. Your vet will go everywhere. They'll see animals of all sorts. They'll be on every farm. So the vet is the number one person, me. You need to ensure that when your vet enters that farm, that, you know, you actually know where they're coming from that particular day. If you're the first farmer they're actually seeing, they can't just walk on with their boots like that. You know, ensure that they cover it, at least cover their boots. If they can't do that, then you should have a footbath at the front of your facility to ensure that they can actually walk through to disinfect. But preferably wear a plastic boot, and they can also walk in the plastic boot through that, you know, footbath, and, you know, that's it.